situation, circumstances where I ask myself frequently, what would Steve do in this situation? What would his response be? How would he sort of navigate this situation? I didn't have a formal sort of mentorship experience with Steve as his postdocs and graduate students. He did mentor a research experience that I had in Bahia as a Fulbright fellow. And decades prior, he had developed collaborations with faculty at the Federal University of Bahia. So he was a natural fit for a mentor for that. But my experience in terms of guidance from him was really more of a sort of life mentor and career mentor in terms of thinking about how to do science in a way that's, ethical and just and really centers the folks that you're working with, as opposed to centering, the many aspects of being an academic that we might center: the publications, the grants, the title changes. He really did center the folks that he worked with, and in many cases, not so much the research questions as much as the way the research is really going to support mobilizing a community, getting them the information they need, empowering them, or supporting them in finding their power to really take action. That is probably one of the most profound things that I've learned from him, is that at the end of the day, it's not the research that's going to make the change. It really is the people who are impacted by the issue that are going to drive the change. And the research is a really important tool to support them in doing that. Some of my most, I think, profound lessons learned were on the 2.5-hour drive to and from Duplin County for community meetings, as well as the experience working on the planning committee of the North Carolina Environmental Justice Network in those meetings. So, a lot of my lessons weren't at Gillings, learning from him there, but in these community meetings. I will close by saying that Steve has had I don't know that he anticipated the impact that he had, in looking at this Zoom collage. I see so many students that he mentored, so many faculty colleagues that he worked with, so many scholars at other universities whose life he inspired, or career he inspired through his work. I'm proud to be able to continue some of his legacy. I think it's important to note that the environmental justice course, the community-driven environmental justice, community-driven research and environmental justice course that he developed some 26 years ago with students from UNC, that course is still going on. That's a course that many students seek out. We have had our highest enrollment this year. We've got 50 plus students enrolled. And we've also launched an environmental justice action research clinic last year, which is a bit of an extension of that course that really allows students to, similar to a law clinic, they can develop skills in community-driven research and support the important work that many communities need, sort of urgent, short-term support. So we've been able to provide that in a really meaningful way. I wanna close there because I'm really excited to hear Danielle's talk, but just really honored to be able to remember and honor Steve's legacy every year in this way.
Thanks for that really nice introduction, Courtney. And just as somebody who hasn't met Steve, it's just sort of a testament to how many people's lives he has impacted, I think, just to sort of hear about how far-reaching his work is and to talk with students who have clearly been very deeply affected by being mentored by him as well and colleagues. So on that note, we're very excited to have Dr. Danielle Zoe Rivera here to speak with us. We thought that her work was a really good fit for the types of work that Steve is doing and sort of the way that we think about sort of how doing research can impact people and communities. So she's an assistant professor of landscape architecture and environmental planning at UC Berkeley. Prior to that, she was an assistant professor of environmental design at the University of Colorado Boulder. And she's got a PhD in urban planning from the University of Michigan with specializations in community development and border studies, as well as a Master of Architecture from the University of Pennsylvania. And she's currently the director of the Just Environments Lab at UC Berkeley with a focus on climate equity and environmental justice. And the mission of the Just Environments Lab is to conduct community-led research in support of underrepresented communities by centering justice and equity in the fight for environmental freedom. So really, a really good fit for the kind of work that Steve was doing. And Dr. Rivera's work examines and addresses environmental injustice and climate inequity in low-income communities of color. She's worked on a number of different things, including flooding, food insecurity, inequities in urban greening, and post-disaster recovery in low-income communities. So we're super excited to have her speak today. And with that, I'll turn the floor over to you.
Wonderful. Can everyone hear me and see the screen? All good. Wonderful. Just wanted to check. Thank you so much for inviting me and having me here today. It's really an honor. It was so lovely to hear those words about Steve Wing. I'm really honored to be here giving a lecture in his memory. And just wanted to say that up front. I really appreciated his work as well. So it's really lovely to follow in his footsteps. I think Christina gave such a great introduction of who I am, but I just want to mention that in addition to the things that she had mentioned at the beginning, I really do think of myself first and foremost as an urban designer and an environmental planner, and bringing that sort of outlook between design and the social sciences, I think is extremely important. So that really foregrounds all the types of work that I do. But today, what I really wanted to talk to you all about is really examining issues of injustice in the built environment, stemming from inequitable distributions and relations of power. The work I'm presenting today actually began over 10 years ago as an examination of Latinx forms of urbanization along the US-Mexico border. Speaking with community early on, multiple issues surrounding the physical environment emerged, but one kept sort of popping up, which was this issue of flooding. And I began this work with a very sort of traditional environmental justice inquiry into the uneven risks of flooding across these low-income border communities, and quickly realized that these issues really existed beyond the local environment, to include issues of disasters, of climate change, but most notably underpinning all of this were uneven and inequitable power relations at almost all levels of the governance of their environment. And so to really reflect these grounded concerns, my work today really merges insights across multiple disciplines. I take from urban design, from community development, disaster planning, climate change planning, and environmental justice. And I think a lot of these subfields, especially within my field of planning and design, are starting to merge in extremely important ways. But to begin all of this, I first wanted to really set a sort of grounding of how I theorize my work, how this relates to this idea of just environments. Christina had mentioned that I'm director of the Just Environments Lab, and we have a very particular definition of what that means to have a just environment. And then what I'll do is I'll discuss how this theory of a just environment and our approach to undertaking this research is framed through the case of the colonias, which I'll talk about what a colonia is in a little bit, but particularly looking at issues of flooding in those communities. And then close with some implications for environmental planning, but also any focus on environmental justice that has a emphasis on rural communities. There are some serious policy barriers that we're trying to address. So I just wanted to present those, and maybe that could set the stage for Q&A. So first, examining the concepts that are underpinning my work, I always like to begin with this quote from Malini Ranganathan, who's a geography scholar. And she clearly states that environmental justice as a movement must fight to abolish all forms of inequalities. In our discussions of environmentalism, and as someone who works in design and planning, we're trained to think about the future and futures that don't exist yet. Like, how do we represent that, or how do we envision these potentials of the future that haven't actually occurred? I'd also add how we really understand how we can abolish forms of inequalities and even how we think about potential environmental futures. And so, building upon works from people like Dr. Ranganathan, my lab at Berkeley seeks to center concerns of equity and justice in all visions and actions for the environment, but also the futures of our environment. So whether in discussions of localized pollution or discussions of climate-induced disaster, as I'll show later, one issue that really prevails is inequitable access to this concept of environmental freedom or a context free of pollution or undue risk. And so that's really what we're trying to work with. And this is a recognition that when environmental injustices occur, it's not the community's relationship to the environment that is at task, but their relationships with those who hold power over them. And this is, to me, a very powerful concept underpinning my work. Procedural vulnerability as a concept has been recognized in Indigenous scholarship extensively in disaster studies. And as a broader concept, we kind of can put procedural vulnerability, I want to say, in contrast to social vulnerability, which is the overwhelming framework we oftentimes use to understand vulnerability in disaster studies in particular. But procedural vulnerability is perhaps an addendum to that, or the idea that disaster itself does not render individuals vulnerable. Rather, it's our institutional responses before, during, and following disaster that do. And this has been, for me, a powerful reframing of how we think about vulnerability, not as the very specific individual characteristics of an individual, but actually the systems, policies, power relationships surrounding them that are actually causing that vulnerability. So a great example of this, to provide an example, I just moved from Colorado, as Christina mentioned, so I had this example at hand. This is Denver County, and in grayscale, you can see the percentage of tracts that are non-white in Denver County. This means higher populations of Black and Mexican American households. And we can see overlaid on that in blue, all of the point sources of pollution across Denver County. These can be factories, these can be wastewater management facilities, many, many different point sources of pollution. You can see there's a very strong correlation between those non-white populations and these point sources of pollution. So, to me, this is a very classic sort of way of thinking about environmental justice that certainly comes out of the work of people like Dr. Robert Bullard. It's extremely important. But one of the questions that a lot of environmental justice scholars have started to ask is, we've been creating or recognizing these correlations between one's identity and one's risk of all kinds of different things, all kinds of different burdens in the environment. But why is that the case? And in just drawing correlations, we are unable to really get to the why. And so for me, procedural vulnerability is a framework through which we can really start to press against these kinds of research projects, build upon them to start to say, well, why is this occurring? Why is this persisting? Really get to the systemic issues underlying this environmental injustice and actually start to address those underlying causes. So as a result, my work, when we talk about the justice in environmental justice, it really builds upon a relational justice framework, which involves understanding power-based relationships through the different issues that we're looking at, oftentimes seeing oppressive and domineering relationships between individuals as the source of inequities. If you're familiar with the work of Iris Marianne Young in the social sciences, her framework of relational justice was really foundational for me as a scholar, and I continue to really build upon that work. So to undertake this work, I really reflect on something that Dr. Robert Bullard said early on in his work on environmental justice, which is that environmental justice work is inherently embedded within community-based organizations, particularly those of color. And I think reflecting on the work of Steve Wing, that seems like something that he was also very focused on as well. And the Just Environments Lab tries to build upon that tradition of community-based research and work by working alongside community-based organizations. And I say sometimes even behind community-based organizations, but never in front of them, to really ground our work in local histories and theories. And in order to accomplish this, we really try to focus on this idea of creating counter-narratives. Counter-narratives are a way of allowing the community to really tell us truly what is going on in their community, try to really decenter the researcher, and through open-ended interviews with community organizers and residents, really understand what it is that they're experiencing. These interviews are long, sometimes they're between 1 to 3 hours in length. And this kind of interviewing subverts what my doctoral advisor at Michigan would call the tyranny of the semi-structured interview, which basically is saying that there's a real place for open-ended interviews and research as a way of decentering any sort of biases that the researcher may be bringing into the field. An example I give of this is when I was a doctoral student first beginning this work in South Texas, I initially thought that I would work in housing, and everything that was written on these communities in academia had focused on housing concerns. But when I went to talk to the community and began these series of open-ended interviews, one organizer actually pushed back against one of my questions and said, well, why does everyone come down here and talk about housing when we have flooding issues? What good is a house if it's going to flood? And that really stuck in my mind, even, you know, almost like 8 years after that interview. It was a way for him, because of the structure of the interview, he could really push back against me and really recenter and reframe the conversation. And I've really tried to build upon that idea that flooding really is the central concern that a lot of residents have. And so that's really the framework we try to bring to all of our research projects. And I'm very happy to talk about these theories and these research techniques in more detail, but wanted to make sure we had time to really talk about how this actually operates through the actual work. And so today I'll focus specifically on our work in South Texas. I just wanted to mention that we also have been doing work in Puerto Rico, in rural Puerto Rico. And also we have a new project that we're starting south of the Bay in California, in Watsonville, California. So we have other projects we're working on as well, but today I'll focus on Texas. So this research project that I'll be describing today focuses specifically on the Rio Grande Valley of South Texas. It's a tri-county region you can see here marked in blue on the right. It's made up of Cameron, Hidalgo, and Starr counties, if you're familiar with Texas. It's juxtaposed by the Gulf of Mexico to the east, which will be really important in a second to remember, and the US-Mexico border to the south. Within this community are a number of impoverished neighborhoods that are known as colonias. Colonias have long suffered from a lack of adequate housing and infrastructure. This really stems from decades of repressed political representation. So oftentimes when people see images like this along the US-Mexico border, they immediately assume that these communities are undocumented or illegal in some way. And I always want to center the fact that these are actually legal communities largely. They followed all of Texas laws for how we develop in unincorporated territories. And they, at the time they were built, were following all the existing building codes. So this is actually, I think, a result of Texan development policies. There's a really great set of articles from the 1990s, so very, very early on in sort of academic recognition of these communities. Jane Larson wrote extensively about how colonial development relates to Texan policy, and actually sees the colonias as the most neoliberal example of development in Texas, even more so than Houston. Usually we turn to Houston and look at their land use and zoning policies and say that's a very neoliberal example. Actually, this is even more so. So just wanted to mention those works. They're very fascinating. But because of their visual appearance, their location, the fact that they are overwhelmingly majority Mexican American, oftentimes these communities have been stigmatized as illegal and undocumented, when actually what we're seeing is that the majority of residents in these communities are US citizens, and increasingly their second, third, and even fourth generation residents at this point. And so that's really what has led to decades of repressed political representation. US Census has not well documented the population here for many, many decades. And this has also led to their inability to gain access to basic services as well. So for many years, they lacked running water, they lacked electricity, they lacked wastewater management, paved roads. And slowly, as you can see in this image, this was from 2015, you can see that they have electricity, but we still have issues with the reliability and affordability of potable water. Many colonias, as you can see here, don't have paved roads. And today I'll really be talking about their lack of stormwater management as well. So colonias are what I would classify as hyper low income communities. So within the Rio Grande Valley, this is one of already the most impoverished regions of the US, and border colonias actually on average make less than even what most people would make in the Rio Grande Valley. Here you can see they on average make about half of what you might see in the rest of Texas. And many colonial households do not make more than $10,000 annually for a household of four. They oftentimes are working three or four jobs to make ends meet even. This leads to a very high poverty rate and near poverty rate in the colonias. And one thing I wanted to mention, if there are others who are on the call who do work along the US-Mexico border, you can actually see colonias along the breadth of the US-Mexico border. I've sort of shown the three counties that make up the Rio Grande Valley here on the right. By far, they have the most colonias, but you also see lots of them in what's known as the Paso del Norte, which is like Doña Ana County with Las Cruces, New Mexico, or in El Paso, Texas. We believe that these two regions have more colonias because traditionally this was housing for migrant farm workers. They would migrate up from Mexico. These two regions were sort of natural crossing points at that time for migrant farm workers entering the US. And this became, especially the Rio Grande Valley, became a hub for information for migrant farm workers, learning about opportunities elsewhere in the US for, you know, picking fruit or other things. Over time now, what we've seen is that actually the majority of Colonia residents work in the service industry and fewer are actually working in agriculture. So I mentioned all of this because I think it's important to note that that focus in the Colonias has become more and more local, whereas before, what we would see is Colonia residents would only seasonally be in the valley. And that's actually how I got my start doing this research. I was researching migrant farm worker health. It was a larger NIH grant, and I was helping with some of the spatial and policy implications from an architecture and planning standpoint in that project. I was led by Darla Lindbergh at Penn State University. And that's where I first heard about the Colonias and sort of the shifting needs of the residents at that time. So I mentioned earlier, a really important part of our work is making sure that we are aligning ourselves with what the community needs and what they're saying. And that means, you know, standing alongside or behind them. This is a map showing in blue over the, you know, 10 years I've been doing research in this area. Many of the different community-based organizations that we've been working with. You can also see in this region, the Colonias in black here. And you can see that they basically dot this whole region. This is a very large region. To get from McAllen to Brownsville is usually about an hour drive. So this is very large scale region. Many of the Colonias are rural or ex-urban. And I'll talk a bit about this in a second, but increasingly we are also seeing a suburbanization of Colonias, especially those that are close to major cities like Brownsville and McAllen. I wanted to mention that some of the organizations that really assist us and we assist them are groups like Lupe and Arise that are well-known Colonia-based organizations that do a lot of advocacy work and grassroots advocacy. And then we also work with nonprofits like Proyecto Azteca is a very important self-help housing nonprofit in this region. The director of Proyecto Azteca is a force within this area on working on Colonia issues. She actually worked with Cesar Chavez in the fields way back when. So did the director of Lupe, one of the community-based organizations. So these organizations have very, very long traditions within the region. This was something when I was undertaking my dissertation that I found very interesting about the region. But it was actually preventing me from doing a lot of academic work. So there was this conflict between what was known in the community about the strength and the power of colonial organizing in this region versus academic writing at the time that talked about the Colonias as being disempowered, as not having the capability to organize. And that was very upsetting to me because you could just walk into any Colonia and you would see all these murals with Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta and all these incredible farm worker organizers. And so I began to, through these open-ended interviews, talking to organizers, see that so many of them, people like Martha Sanchez, who just retired from Lupe, all of them had known and had worked with Cesar Chavez in South Texas, realizing that there was a whole aspect of Cesar Chavez's work in South Texas, not just in California, that was overlooked. And that work was specifically being done in the Colonias, these migrant farm worker communities. And so as many of these organizers are starting to really retire from their positions, we captured their stories, captured that different framework of organizing that Chavez tried to advocate for in South Texas versus California. It's still illegal to unionize farm workers in Texas, so he had to take a very different approach here. But we captured all of that in this article, and that really allowed us to understand how the organizations we're working with operate, what are those theories of organizing that underpin their work. All of it was very, very thoughtfully done, and this really highlighted all of that work. Also, it was a message to other colonia-based scholars that, you know, this region and these peoples are very organized. And just because they're rural doesn't mean that they're incapable of organizing. I think that's a huge fallacy that we have in the US. If people are far apart, you can't see them, then somehow they can't find ways to connect with one another. So all of that, in spending my time with these organizations and really listening in community meetings, community events, one issue continues to pop up over the 10 years that I've been working in this region, and that's flooding. And I mentioned earlier that there's a huge focus on housing improvement in the colonias, which is extremely important. There's a lot of substandard housing in these communities. But what happens is the programs that we've been running in colonias to improve housing are very unevenly implemented. And so here, this is a really compelling photo. This was a colonia that is north of Weslaco, Texas. You can see in the background that yellow home. I can actually pinpoint these now in the environment. This is a self-help house from Proyecto Azteca. So that household was able to work with five other households to build a house and bring it to their site. So they basically get the home for little to no money, but they have to help four other households also build their homes, and they get all kinds of instruction on how to do construction safely, about building codes, household management. It's a fantastic program. But unfortunately, Proyecto Azteca, and last I talked to them, they had a wait list of households that was numbering over 2,000. And on average, they've been completing about 30 or so homes a year, and their funding has been shrinking. And so they've been trying to find ways to continue their mission of dealing with substandard housing, despite the shrinking funding and sort of the very slow, I mean, building a house takes a long time, that slow sort of process of building these homes. Is there a way maybe they could speed it up or make it cheaper without compromising the quality of the housing? The net result of that in the environment is what we see here. So the neighbor in the background has been able to lift their home to get away from floodwaters and has a better roof, better sort of envelope of the house. The neighbor in the foreground wasn't as lucky. They were dealing with all kinds of flooding concerns. You can see them moving earth around, trying to deal with the floodwaters in this part of the colonia. Actually, when I visited the site, I have another photo. I should have showed you all. To the left here, you can see the standing water. So this area is constantly sort of dealing with flooding. We could see indications of that. Eventually, it looks like this home just decided it wasn't worth trying to deal with this flooding issue and moved out. And it looks like they're just using the home now for storage for a business. And so this is the uneven sort of development and policies that we've had thus far in trying to address colonial issues. So we're hoping we can come up with solutions that are more systemic in nature. And what's important to note is that these issues of flooding, so I should go back. I mentioned that when I was on the site for documentation at that time, there was standing water. It had just rained very lightly the day before. Oftentimes, colonias will flood in very, very light rainstorms. It doesn't take a major rainstorm event to cause flooding, but they do have a significant and unignorable threat of hurricanes and tropical storms. And when these storms pass through this region, it causes widespread devastation, unfortunately. The most recent example of this would be Hurricane Hannah, which just happened in 2020, which caused widespread flooding in the colonias. But one of the more, for the community, one of the more memorable disaster events that recently occurred was Hurricane Dolly in 2008, which was a Category 1 storm that actually made landfall in the region. And Hurricane Dolly, as it passed through the region here, the colonias you can see here, especially those in Hidalgo and Cameron County, were on the windy side of the storm, which caused significant damages to roofs. And they also experienced floodwaters throughout their communities, though that water was reportedly lingering in their neighborhoods for upwards of 180 days. It caused all kinds of public health concerns. There were outbreaks of dengue fever. They had outbreaks of cholera. Nowadays, I would also worry about Zika. It didn't exist at the time, but we were very concerned about that. The water lingered due to an issue with stormwater management in this region, which is something my team is trying to look at right now. You have the Rio Grande, which is levied in most parts of this community. It's a levied border wall that exists here. That causes all kinds of problems on both sides of the border. When the counties here and the cities would like to release stormwaters into the river and get them out into the Gulf of Mexico, actually what ends up happening is that the international national bodies that regulate the Rio Grande, which obviously you can imagine that's like very fraught and contentious with, you know, water rights and with that binational agreements, they will actually close floodgates, which causes that water to go back into the community or to linger in the community. And there's no way of actually getting rid of it because of different agreements. And so we're learning that that's really what happened with Hurricane Dolly. The floodgates closed on the Rio Grande. Sometimes with a big storm event like this, they can remain shut for a month or two, and that can cause floodwaters to linger if there's not proper stormwater management at a regional or local scale. And so what was additionally disappointing after Hurricane Dolly was that the colonias were dealing with widespread flood damage, roof damages. And so Lupe compelled many of the residents to apply for FEMA funding. That was going to be their best way to get money to actually address the problem sort of plot by plot. But unfortunately, 85% of colonial applications were denied by FEMA after Hurricane Dolly. And in disaster studies, we understand this is probably about two or three times the rejection rate we would normally expect from this kind of event. And so this is a ridiculously high rejection rate. Many colonial households did not have the money to refute these rulings. In order to dispute this ruling from FEMA, you actually have to have a contractor come out and actually state, no, actually FEMA, you got it wrong, and actually write a report. Oftentimes after disasters, we see that contractors will inflate the cost of these kinds of reports to the point where they're a couple hundred dollars, which is totally out of reach for a typical colonial household. And so the colonial-led organization Lupe decided to sue FEMA. They thought it might be easier to have the community pool their resources together. This is very much a part of their organizing model. Pay little bits of money in, we can get a lawyer and sue FEMA. And they were actually able to successfully sue FEMA. Unfortunately, it took a 9-year court battle to get to that point. And you can imagine for disaster, 9 years after a disaster, waiting for aid is totally, it's not very helpful. Many colonial households were displaced after the storm, what we're referring to increasingly as disaster gentrification. Many of them were moving to places like Oklahoma or Northern Texas because they just couldn't afford to keep living in their homes. Many of them were living with molds and other issues which were causing asthma rates to spike, and it just was becoming untenable for them. But Lupe and the rest of us still see that lawsuit as a victory because it at least set a precedent for other low-income communities dealing with similar issues to sue FEMA, and hopefully those court cases go through faster. So we've seen low-income communities throughout Houston also fighting these battles. And also in my work in Puerto Rico, they've been asking me about this lawsuit as well as a precedent for them. We wrote up the case. This is available through Lincoln Institute of Land Policy. They have a suite of case studies that they provide for urban planning practitioners, and we wrote up this lawsuit as a case study, if you're interested in that. Through talking, doing interviews with those individuals who were part of the lawsuit and actually reading through the documents in the lawsuit, we realized that two issues emerged with FEMA's relationship with low-income communities of color. So first is that they instituted what we would call a territorialization of poverty, or basically this reification of ideas of informality and illegality in the sort of physical footprint of the region. Essentially what they had done was they had given inspectors maps of the colonias that actually show their locations. And basically what happens is if you submit an application to FEMA for relief funding after a disaster, what they will do is before they give you the monies, you have to actually prove that the damage is actually on your home, what you have actually said in your application actually exists. And they send a home inspector out to actually confirm that, yes, that damage actually exists on your home. The problem is after a disaster, oftentimes FEMA will receive so many applications that there just aren't enough home inspectors locally who are able or available to actually certify these damages. And so FEMA has to actually pull inspectors oftentimes from very far afield. So for in the case of Hurricane Dolly, many of these inspectors were coming from other parts of Texas that are very far away. Texas takes like 12 hours to cross. So you have people coming all the way up from Dallas, maybe even from Oklahoma and Colorado. So they might not even be familiar with the state. To familiarize these inspectors with the region, FEMA had given them maps noting the locations of colonias, which in and of itself isn't perhaps that much of an issue, but they also told the inspectors that when you enter a colonia, please expect deferred maintenance. And this is really bad. Deferred maintenance is essentially one of the terms FEMA uses to deny funding requests to households. Deferred maintenance essentially is damages that can be attributed to a lack of maintenance on a home and not to the disaster itself. And FEMA will not provide any funding and relief funds for damages that are not attributed to a disaster. So there are many, many different studies in the field of disaster studies that shows how this is weaponized against low-income communities that oftentimes cannot afford to keep up with certain types of maintenance on their homes. In the colonias, oftentimes households don't have the money to keep up with costly roof repairs. And that really is what led to that high rejection rate. And so we saw this as a major procedural vulnerability and are really, along with many, many other scholars, trying to advocate FEMA to change their deferred maintenance policy in line with what we're actually seeing as the need in low-income communities. And so the point of highlighting this case study to planning scholars and to policymakers was to really compel FEMA to start to change that relationship. And hearing similar stories from other communities, they actually are starting to think about how they might have a different relationship with low-income communities and how that actually gets manifest in their programs, which is really exciting to see. This work on flooding in the colonias also reaches to a more urban design level, where we're asking how we can also mitigate flood risk in colonias individually, sort of working in tandem with a local design nonprofit known as BC Workshop. They have an office in Brownsville, Texas, and have been doing work with colonias and flooding issues for a very, very long time. They've done some of the original work, I would say, on this issue. What we're doing now is looking at a Texas Water Development Board survey. So Texas Water Development Board covers everything water in the state, including issues of stormwater. And after Hurricane Dolly, after hearing about the lawsuit with Lupe, between Lupe and FEMA, Texas Water Development Board realized that they needed to start addressing these stormwater issues, and they did a survey of 75 of the, what we estimate, 2,300 colonias in this region. Obviously, they didn't survey even close to a lot of the colonias in this area, but we thought it was a really great start. Here you can see the colonias they surveyed are either highlighted in orange, which were the ones they surveyed that they didn't find significant flood risk, or the colonias they surveyed in blue that actually had significant flood risk. And I tried to highlight those because some of them are very small. And so what we're trying to do is we have studied their survey data, we've spatialized it in GIS, and we're trying to understand what the state of Texas has in mind for these communities. And we're actually in the process of reporting this back to our community partners so they can understand if this can be an organizing base. Do they agree with what Texas is proposing, or do they think it's insufficient for what needs to happen for these communities? What we found so far, these are just some of the initial findings, is that the Texas Water Development Board is overwhelmingly suggesting retention ponds and only very, very infrequently suggesting more nature-based solutions, which is something that the community is not necessarily happy about. And so that's really where we're at right now. What might it look like to propose nature-based solutions? But the issue here is that we're dealing with a very rural population. Colonias are traditionally unincorporated. And so to suggest certain kinds of nature-based solutions, or to say, as one organizer wanted to see stormwater management systems married with other forms of open space or green infrastructure, you need to have a strong local entity to really maintain those infrastructures. And in Texas, what we've heard from county officials is that they feel uncomfortable and ill-equipped to take ownership of certain forms of open space, parks, trails, those kinds of things. They just don't have the capacity to do that. And so our current work now is to work with county officials to say, well, why do you feel like you don't have the capacity to support these kinds of infrastructures in unincorporated areas? And how could we maybe perhaps start to provide certain kinds of training or advocate for more resources for you to be able to take on this kind of infrastructure? This is an interesting contrast to my work in California, because in California, we don't necessarily have those issues. And so I have a case study across California and Texas to look at these concerns. I will skip this because it's a long explanation, because I want to make sure we have time for Q&A, but we're also looking at issues of potential gentrification that might come out of suddenly placing parks and other trails in these rural communities that didn't have access to this infrastructure before. And this has become a huge concern in a lot of the planning literature. You can see here, we did a systematic lit review of concerns of environmental gentrification. And just in the past 3 years, planners have been paying more attention to this. And then lastly, we're very concerned about who's really gonna take ownership of these infrastructures in the long run. During Hurricane Hannah, I was receiving reports of colonias that had been certainly early pilot studies of different kinds of stormwater management. Actually, neighbors had to take turns going out to different channels and pull debris out from the channels to make sure water was still flowing out into the stormwater system. And so, and I've heard reports of this also in places like Houston, the kinds of infrastructure that we propose in a community like a colonia or historically Black community in Houston is not of the same quality as those which were proposing in majority white communities in Texas. This is actually something Texas Housers has been pushing HUD on and other federal agencies. They actually got some of the federal agencies to admit that this is a historic problem. Actually, that was a huge thing yesterday. We were all celebrating because this means that we might be able to compel Texas to have a more equitable distribution of these kinds of resources. So it was a groundbreaking moment. To finish, just some quick takeaways I'd like to propose from this case study. Some major barriers that we see in this, trying to assist the colonias, which I'm also seeing in other unincorporated and rural communities, is that we need to address the capacity, ability, and willingness of counties to undertake environmental planning efforts in these areas. We need to fight for that equitable distribution of stormwater management and resources, stormwater management resources and maintenance. Maintenance component is really important because even after we've built these systems, there are still a lot of inequities that are being perpetuated in the kinds of systems we're building and how they operate and how much time neighborhoods have to spend actually maintaining that infrastructure if the government isn't. And then lastly, we need to recognize the need for multi-purpose infrastructures in the colonias. This has been a huge issue. If we're dealing with stormwater management, why can't we marry that with open space? That's actually a huge question. Even with my work in California, we encounter this as a major barrier all the time. Oftentimes federal funding wants to see the stormwater infrastructure over here, and really we can't have it be multi-use. So that's something we're dealing with. And also taking all these things into account, climate change is going to have a compounding impact on these issues. And so we can't ignore that as well. So to close, just some thoughts about how this really impacts environmental justice for the future. I really see the field of environmental justice writ large moving away from only focusing on that distributive or material form of justice, that idea of sort of what's the field of undue risks that we've been seeing, but actually asking why do we see these undue risks being placed on certain communities? What are those power imbalances that cause this issue to be perpetuated? And then lastly, I think there's more interconnectivity between different forms of justice studies, mainly environmental justice, climate justice, and disaster justice. Increasingly are fields that can't be disentangled. So oftentimes when we talk about environmental injustice, we're also seeing certain forms of climate injustices or disaster injustices as well. So with that, I just wanted to close with this quote from Kelly Hayes, which I thought was extremely important, really shows the issue of procedural vulnerability. This was in response to the number of hurricanes that that Southern Louisiana has been experiencing. She said, folks are dying and very serious people are busy describing the water. And what she wanted to see was more of a discussion of why these individuals were actually experiencing the disaster more readily than others. But we weren't getting to that conversation. So with that, I will open it up for questions. Thank you so much for inviting me, and I look forward to the discussion. I love Zoom. Silent claps, but I appreciate it. Yeah, let me open the chat. If anyone has any questions, I can take them via the chat, or I think at this point they can unmute.
I have a quick question. So first of all, thank you so much, Danielle, for sharing this presentation with all of us. It's definitely very inspiring and very important to listen and hear more about these different projects that are helping advance more equity within a lot of different BIPOC communities, and definitely just helping share definitely these stories, which is definitely super important for advancement in this field. And my question is, during this past year with the pandemic going on, I am just curious to hear your insight on how this project with Las Colonias, how potentially before and after and during, how that process of kind of working with the community members and now looking forward with like this, these different concerns environmentally, how has that process been looking like, and what is your insight on that?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think one of the issues we encounter, I wouldn't even say it was an issue, is the, when the pandemic began, the community had sort of one set of concerns before the pandemic that they were extremely concerned with. And in and through the pandemic, those priorities shifted radically and understandably. So many Colonia households do not have access to the internet in their homes. They have to go elsewhere to access the internet. It's been a huge problem, but has always sort of been on the back burner on the minds of the residents when they were really fighting for other, what they saw more important infrastructures first. And with the pandemic, children were sent home from school and were supposed to Zoom in, but if you don't have Zoom at home, what are you supposed to do? And that became a massive, massive issue for Colonia children, as they couldn't access school. And many of them, I was receiving reports of, you know, children sitting in McDonald's and Burger King parking lots trying to, you know, bump off of the fast food restaurant's Wi-Fi in order to access their class. And so the community-based organizations we worked with were much more concerned through the pandemic about making sure that the residents had access to equitable access to the internet. And then also making sure that they were hearing about, you know, vaccinations and getting adequate masks for their jobs. Many of them work in service. So obviously, you know, the COVID rates, this is one of the first regions of Texas that really saw an early spike in COVID rates. Obviously, through all of this, flooding concerns sort of took a backseat, and we had to respect that. And so throughout the pandemic, and this is actually the flooding report I mentioned that's coming out in May, was actually supposed to come out about a year or two ago. And I put it on hold just because it just didn't feel appropriate to be burdening them with those concerns when they had more pressing pandemic concerns. And I think that's always part of the difficulty of doing community engaged research. If you're doing it properly and truly ethically, is that oftentimes the community is not working at the same pace as an academic, and you have to respect that and try and figure out on your own how you're going to resolve those tensions. So I think that was probably the biggest thing through the pandemic. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for sharing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see a couple of hands up. I see David first. Do you want to go first?
Thank you so much. I thought this was great and it was really interesting. I was wondering if you could talk a bit more about, you raised this issue of procedural vulnerability. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was really kind of a powerful way of framing, you know, something that in public health and epidemiology, we will often talk about different types of vulnerability, whether they're characteristics of a person, like their age, or their, even if their relational aspects like socioeconomic status. But procedural vulnerability kind of really focuses you on certain issues of responsibility or culpability about, mm-hmm. as you said, decisions that maybe occur before, during, and after, particularly in a disaster setting. I thought that was fantastic. So I was just wondering if you could expand on that a bit.
Yeah, certainly. I think it's really been a recognition that, and this is what's currently happening in Texas with the amazing work that Texas Housers has been doing around issues of flooding across the entirety of the Gulf regions of Texas. It's recognizing that these individuals aren't somehow inherently vulnerable to flooding and to disaster, which unfortunately, I mean, not all of the social vulnerability literatures have done this, but there's sometimes a propensity to misread social vulnerability literature as somehow blaming the individual for their individual characteristics. And to me, procedural vulnerability is a really great way of preventing that from happening and recognizing that, you know, if you read procedural vulnerability literature, oftentimes what you'll see is a lot of individuals who are talking about histories of colonization and how that affected Indigenous communities' abilities to build certain kinds of infrastructure, maybe even made it illegal for them to build certain kinds of infrastructure that leads to their actual vulnerabilities, higher risks of disaster. And in this case, I mentioned, you know, the procedural vulnerability here is consistently marking these communities as illegal, informal as illegal, which is something I really think about a lot, how we frame informality in the built environment in the US. And that's immediately, unlike other countries, we immediately tie informality to illegality. And that's prevented the colonias for many, many years from getting many basic services and led to that increased vulnerability. And really that is, you know, anytime we talk about them, we really need to focus on those histories, those systems of, you know, racism and prejudice that are built into all of this as a way of understanding why we have those vulnerabilities now, why we see the risks unevenly distributed the way we do. So yeah, I think it's just a really important basis for approaching all the research from a very, very core point of view. Yeah, I think we have Ray.
Hi, thank you again so much for your talk. So I'm actually from Southern Arizona, and we're seeing this kind of interesting situation where due to our, you know, historic 30-year drought and just less and less water in the area, we're seeing more flash floods, excuse me, in just that after a while, there's so little water and the soil becomes so dry and so compacted that it doesn't absorb the rainfall well. So I guess I was interested in whether or not you're seeing more flash floods in this area and whether or not that's changing kind of the definition of the area that's at flood risk of now. It's not necessarily river, like historic riverbanks or lower grounds, but larger areas of flatland that may experience flash floods.
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think in this region, they just have a natural propensity for flooding, and that kind of has two factors. And so at once there's the Rio Grande, which wants to change its course in this region. This is part of the estuary of the Rio Grande. And if you go to Brownsville, Texas, you'll even see old former segments of the Rio Grande. They call them resacas. They're little ponds of water or lakes of water. Most other parts of the US-Mexico border region have paved over and filled in these former courses of the Rio Grande. For some reason, Brownsville never did. But it's just an important reminder that this is supposed to be a very dynamic wetland system, a very important delta region, and that in setting the course of the Rio Grande, because it is supposed to be, you know, it marks the border in this area, what we've done is created all kinds of environmental issues. And I mentioned the levying of the Rio Grande in this region, which also causes flooding issues on both sides of the border, is also a concern. And the soil here also is just very, very compacted. And so naturally, this region just doesn't have the sort of infiltration rates that you would see elsewhere. So these two things together just leads to a natural propensity for flooding in this region. But sort of what you were describing in Arizona, I haven't seen it necessarily in this case, but I have seen it in my work in California. And so in the Watsonville region where I've been working, again, you have a river, the Pajaro River, which has been levied. It used to flow naturally like the Rio Grande or the Mississippi River would naturally want to. And what we see there is, you know, obviously the California droughts, we do see that kind of flash flood situation becoming more and more more and more sort of heightened over time. And so I think maybe not so much in this region, but I certainly am seeing that in other cases that I'm working in. And it's a serious concern. The whole idea of mapping flood risk is so political and so contentious right now. Do we change the FEMA flood maps? What does it mean to change them? If we were to change them and mark sort of broader areas as at high risk of floods, what does that mean for the affordability of those areas or the ability of people to sell their homes and move out of those areas and, you know, actually make their money back? It's very complex. So yeah, very, very interesting set of concerns that we've been dealing with. Yeah, I think I see one in the chat. Let me see. Yeah, we have a question in the chat. Says, could you talk about who owns the land in the Colonias? Are they owned by landlords or the actual people who live there? And just wondering how that impacts power dynamics that are affecting your residents. That's an excellent question. I meant to mention it earlier in the presentation and forgotten on the Colonias slide, so I'm happy you brought that up. What's interesting here in the Colonias is that these lands were subdivided by farmers. When they decided to retire, they kind of saw these neighborhoods as a way of financing their retirement at that time. So what you can see even today in certain Colonias, you'll see one plot of land that says for sale. Some of them are vacant, some of them have people on them. These plots weren't typically all sold at the same time, but slowly over time, the farmer would sell them. Back in the early days of colonial development, prior to a lot of the laws passed by Texas in the late 90s, we saw what's known as contract for deed agreements as the way that colonial residents were able to buy and finance the land. So they bought the land with no home on it through these contract for deed agreements. What that means is that they were essentially getting a loan from the farmer to be able to buy the land. The problem with the contract for deed agreements is it can be extremely predatory. And so if the colonia household missed one payment from the farmer could actually take back the land. This meant that the colonial household was incentivized to not actually invest in the housing that they were placing on the land. That's why we see a lot of secondhand RVs, secondhand trailers, or in this image here, you see someone who was using secondhand building materials in order to construct a home. And so groups like the Texas Rio Grande Legal Aid have done an excellent job of helping colonial residents get out of those contract for deed agreements over time so that they can feel like they have more ownership of their home and of the land, that they're more secure. And when that started happening, then we did see, I can't say if it's one-to-one relationship, but sort of anecdotally, I felt a change in the community, like they could actually start to vie against the local sheriff or vie against, you know, their representatives in Austin. And so I think that that does matter. It makes a huge difference. Nowadays, what we're seeing as a lot of colonias are becoming more suburbanized, especially those that are in and around Brownsville and McAllen that are currently seeing massive gentrification. And that's starting to push people who otherwise wouldn't move near the colonias, some colonia residents are realizing that they could actually potentially rent their land and their home to someone else and make more money to pay their mortgage and actually live even further away. And so rentals are starting to increase. And this is the work of Noah Durst at Michigan State's fantastic housing scholar. He's been trying to track the rates of rentals in the Colonias, and we're seeing that spiking. Sorry, I love when people ask that question because it sounds like it should be like a two-word answer, and it's actually really complicated. Yeah, any other questions for me? I don't know if I see. Oh, that's good to hear that Steve Wing would have enjoyed this.
If there are no more questions, I just want to say thank you so much, Dr. Rivera, for showing us what the work you've done, as well as a lot of different information I don't think that we would come across in our epidemiology world as much that we definitely need, including the emphasis on procedural vulnerability, I think is something that we could definitely incorporate in our field. And I wanted to thank all of you for joining as well and honoring Dr. Steve Wink's memory.
Well, thank you so much for having me. This was really lovely.